Saints, this is Mina Lee Jones with Faithful Walk Healing Ministries, and today is Wednesday, October 12th of 2022, and I'm coming to you this afternoon with a dire warning to the body of Christ, to the church, especially the Western church here in the U.S. I'm going to share with you all a dream and a scripture, along with some things that was given to me in a dream, and I'm also going to talk to you all about another warning that has been given to me regarding our children. And so I'm going to start off with a disclosure, which is not something that I typically do, but I want to put this out there, and that's in regards to what I'm about to share with you. I know that we as Christians, we have our faves, we have our cliques, we have our sects of people that we like to listen to, places we like to go, things we like to read. And we all have this available to us because of the internet. It's just a click of a button for most. But as we go into our cliques and we go into our favorites and we have our biased opinions about different people who are believers or spirit-filled Christians or even leadership, we need to understand that God can use and will use anyone. With that being said, my disclosure is to please listen to what I have to tell you. Whatever you have an opinion of Mina Lee Jones or Faithful Walk Healing Ministries, I need you to put that aside at this moment. And I need you to hear this warning, because this warning is for the church and it is a very important warning. And what I will ask of you is to, as I do with everything, take it to prayer. Ask the Lord for confirmation, but don't merely just toss it aside because you don't like who I am or you don't like our ministry or you don't like what we represent. I want to remind everyone that God uses whoever he chooses to use. And a great example of that was a mule on the side of the road in a mountainside that saved Balaam's life. Remember that God can speak through whoever he wants and whoever he chooses to execute his will. And I want to put that out there and ask you all to consider everything that you hear today. Take it to prayer and share it with as many people as you can. So I want to start off with a dream that was given to me approximately 3 days ago. And this particular night, I had very great trouble sleeping. I felt like I was under a spiritual attack, and it was between the third and the fourth watch. And so I got up, and I, after tossing and turning and feeling this battle in my spirit, I decided to go into prayer. And in prayer, I went into spiritual warfare and began to rebuke the devil and bind any strongholds and break any curses or psychic prayers. As you all know, we're in the month of October, and it is a month of great darkness. And then we've gone into a new shift of darkness too, as we've entered into a new season post-tabernacles. And so I felt a relief after going into this spiritual warfare, and I had to get up quickly. And because my husband, he gets up very early in the morning to go to work, and I get up with him and make his breakfast every morning. So I had to get up and start my day. But afterwards, I returned home and I fell asleep on my couch, which is not something that I typically do. And I fell asleep and I went into a deep dream. And in this dream, I found myself in a facility. It was a church, but it wasn't a typical church, as in like brick and mortar with steeples and stained glass buildings, but more like a wide facility that had been rented or bought or purchased and turned into a sanctuary. And there were many, many, many people there of all backgrounds, races, ages, or what have you. And I was approached by a pastor in this dream, and this pastor has gone home to be with the Lord in reality, but he was there in his dream, and he came up to me with a warm smile as though he was anticipating me. I knew in the dream I had to give the people a warning. And so this pastor also knew that I was coming to give a word and to warn the people. And so we began trying to gather the people into the sanctuary to get them to come. And I had what I needed to share with them written on several pieces of post-it notes that were in my hand. And so I waited as I saw the people begin to slowly gather into this one particular section of the building that seemed to be what you would deem a sanctuary. I remember seeing this woman come in who, in the dream, I knew, but in reality, I have no idea who she is. But she was a very tall woman, middle-aged, and she was dressed in all white. She owned a simple white dress, and her hair was blocked like platinum, white, silver. And she was older in the face, but she was very tall. And she came over to me, and she was talking to me in the dream. And she was saying it was very good to see me again. But she spoke of another lady who was supposed to have been with her, yet this woman did not come with her, and her name was Bonnie. Now, on this side of the fence, so to speak, I do not know anyone named Bonnie. But in the dream, I knew who she was talking about. And I was sorry to hear that this lady Bonnie had not come to hear, because we both agreed that she was supposed to be there. But I noticed that the people were just slowly trickling in, and yet it wasn't filling up the sanctuary. There were many people who were missing. There were a lot more people in the building than those who were coming into the sanctuary to hear me speak. And I was a little distraught at this. And I talked to the pastor and I said, "These are, where are all the people? Where are the rest of the people at?" And he couldn't seem to give me a straight answer. And we couldn't seem to get the rest of the people to come. So there was just a small group of people. And I decided to just speak to that group. And the pastor said, "Well, perhaps you can speak to this group. And then afterwards, we can get you to go to the other side of the building and speak to the rest of them." And so I agreed to that. And so I began speaking, and I began talking from the notes that I had in my hands, which was, again, on these little post-it notes. And I began telling the people, began giving them this warning. And the warning was that we were not prepared, saints. The warning was that the church had fallen asleep spiritually, that they had become complacent, and that we believed that nothing terrible was coming to our country until the rapture happened. That we had been teaching that good times were ahead, that things, there would be a shift that was coming, and these were lies. I began telling the people that there was war coming to our coastlands, and that they had already prepared to bomb us, and that we were not ready, and that we were not prepared, and that we needed to begin to prepare. And I was desperate about my speech. I was desperate in my voice to the people, telling them that we needed to make sure that we were prepared to meet our Maker, that we needed to make sure that we were praying, that we were fasting, that we were listening to instructions, that we needed to make sure that we were in contact with our loved ones to begin to prepare for what was coming, that we needed to prep also physically by stocking up on food and water. And I was telling the people, and I was, in a sense, almost just in a desperate way, trying to get them to understand what I was saying. And the people were very quiet, but they were very attentive. And it seems as though what I said to them struck them, and it struck them deep. And they went, they gathered up when I was done to begin to leave, but they were leaving to begin to prepare. It was like what I said to them had penetrated them, and this was the result of it. And so when they left, I went to the left side of the building where the majority of the rest of the sanctuary was. But on the left side of the building were cubicles, like you would see in a call center. And all of these people were in these cubicles, and all you hear was voices from people talking. Some people were visiting one another in the cubicles. Some people were in the cubicles alone. Some people were talking on the phone. It was like all of these voices, but the majority of the people were there on the left side of the building. And so I was trying to get their attention, and I was saying, "Excuse me, excuse me." And I only saw like a couple of heads, a few heads pop up above the cubicles to see where the voice was coming from. And they made eye contact with me. But there was only just a few people. I mean, very few. Probably I could count on one hand. The rest of the people continued in their conversations and their chatters or what have you. And so I began walking up and down the aisles, trying to get the people's attention. I said, "Listen, we need to gather in the sanctuary. I have something. I have a very important message to tell you." But the people were not trying to hear what I had to say. They were not bothered or alarmed by my voice. And I noticed that in each cubicle was a phone, like an office phone that you would probably have in a regular call center. And the woman that I told you about that was dressed in a simple white dress, she was following me in the dream as I was kind of in a distraught going up and down these, or in a distraught way going up and down these aisles trying to get people's attention. I turned back to look at her and I said to her, I said, "They're not listening. I can't get them to listen." And I felt this frustration coming over me. But I noticed that music was playing in the phones. and off the phones, like all the phones were on speaker, and there was all simultaneous music. In other words, like everyone was listening to the same thing. And I stopped to pay attention to what the music was that was coming through the phones. And I noticed that it was Christian music, like contemporary Christian music that would have been played on any type of modern day Christian radio station. And everyone was listening to the same station or the same song at the same time. And so I walked over to a empty cubicle where there was a phone on the table. And I looked to see where the music was coming from. And that too, that phone also had a speaker and the same song was playing out. But there was a screen that was on the phone and it was like it was tuned in or tuned to whatever the station was that the music was coming from. And I looked at the woman and I said to her, I said, I'm not going to overexert myself with these people. They obviously are not interested in what I have to say. And so the ones that came, they heard, but I'm not going to just go above and beyond to try to reach these people. I was trying to, but they were not interested. But when I looked down at the screen of the phone, I saw the number 414. And then there was Greek written underneath it. And I remember paying attention to it and thinking in the dream, oh, this is the radio station, perhaps, that everyone is tuned into. And I began to come out of the dream. And so when I woke up out of the dream, I thought about the numbers 414. And I decided to go to Strong Concordance because, again, the letters underneath there were Greek. Now, if you know anything about Strong Concordance, it has all of these words with the numbers attached to it. And there's the Hebrew version of them, and then there's the Greek version of them. And that is because we know that the Bible, the first half of the Bible was written in Hebrew and Aramaic. And the second half of the Bible, which is the New Testament, was written in Greek. So what I decided to do is I decided to look up the Greek end of what 414 represented, since I saw Greek letters underneath that number. And this is what I found, and I want to share with you all. And there was a scripture that went with it, and I'm going to share that scripture with you. The number 414 was a word, and I'm going to try to pronounce it for you, so please bear with me, because my Greek is not good. It's the word an ektos, and that is what the word was. And there were two scriptures associated with the word an ektos, and they were Matthew chapter 10, verses 14 and 15, and again, Matthew 11, verses 21 and 22. And this is where things begin to really open up here. And I'm going to read these scriptures to you so you have an understanding of what this meant, because it tied right in to my dream. So again, the first scripture was Matthew 10, 14 and 15. And I'm going to read that to you here. It says, and these are the words of Jesus, by the way, they are written in red. So this is him talking. He says, and whosoever will not receive you nor hear your words when you depart from that house or city, shake the dust off your feet. Assuredly, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah and the day of judgment than for that city. And the second scripture that is listed is the next chapter over, chapter 11, verses 21 and 22. And again, this is Jesus also speaking. And it says, woe to you, Chorazin, woe to you, Bethsaida, for if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. And so that word that I gave you in Greek, the an ektos, is the word more tolerable. And that's the scripture references for that particular word. And I found that to be interesting in this dream, because this is what was on the screen that I thought, well, perhaps this is the station that they're listening to. Everyone was listening to Christian music, yet that was the word that was in there. And it's a warning. And of course, when you go into chapters 10 and 11 and those particular verses, Jesus is giving warning to the Jews at that time. And the reason why he's comparing it to the Gentile countries or providences of Sodom and Gomorrah and Chorazin and Sidon is because they had the Messiah in front of them. But not only did they have the Messiah in front of him and them, and they did not accept him, nor was willing to listen to him. But in addition to that, they had the Torah. They had the law that was given to them by God through Moses. And they had, so basically they were without excuse. And Jesus was saying to them in both scripture references that if these Gentile nations had what you had, if these countries, if these providences had even part of what you had, part that would have been given to you, would have been bestowed upon you, they would have repented. But yet they were judged as Gentile nations. We know because with Tyre, it talks about their pride. You can find them in the book of Isaiah. You can also find them referenced in Ezekiel, and I believe also Jeremiah. But Sodom and Gomorrah, we know about that story in Genesis. We know what happened. So we're talking about countries and providences that was known for either harassing the Israelites for their pride, for their pagan worship, for their child sacrifices, for their perversion. And God rained judgment down on these Gentile nations. But they were not, they did not have a relationship with the God of the Israelites. They did not have the law of the Torah, and they definitely did not have the Messiah. And so for the ones that was presented with all of this, that had the law in front of them, they knew right from wrong, so to speak, is what it boiled down to. They had the opportunity to change their ways, and they chose not to. And so this is why Jesus said, it would be more tolerable. The judgment that fell on those countries is more tolerable compared to the judgment that is about to fall on you, who have everything that you need to make an effort to change, and you choose not to change it. Have the warnings in front of you, but you choose not to change. And there's so many in the church right now, saints, we simply will not make the decision to let God change us. And I prayed before I did this video, and I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, please, as I put this video out, speak through me so that these words will penetrate the hearts of these wavering Christians. There are so many wavering Christians in the church right now, especially in the Western church. There are so many people who are sitting in churches, who are in the choirs, who attend regular Bible studies. Some of you are into messianic teachings or Hebrew word roots. It doesn't matter what your background is. There are so many in the church right now who profess that Jesus Christ or Yeshua is their Lord and Savior, that he's their God, that he's their King. But yet we are still bound by spirits of perversion. We are still bound by pride. We are adulterers. We are fornicators. We are liars and we are thieves. We are greedy, and we're full of pride. There's so much bitterness. There's so many people who you haven't forgiven, the people that have offended you, those who hate you, some of the people that go all the way back to your mamas and daddies that weren't there, or the mothers and fathers that abused you. Some of us is other relatives. Some of us is our co-workers. Some of us is our ex-spouses. Some of them it's our the fathers or mothers of our children, whether we married them or not. But we're dealing with so much iniquity in our hearts, and the Lord is warning us. He is warning us that we are not prepared for what's coming. And then there are the ones that are, there's still a vast group of Christians here in the United States who are prophesying, who are preaching, who are saying that good times are still coming. They're still saying this. They're still saying that everything's going to change with an election. They're still saying that God is going to relent judgment, even after all that has happened, even after a solar eclipse, even after torrential rains and storms and earthquakes and unprecedented fires, and even after COVID-19 and the deaths, the sweeping deaths that have swept across the planet. People are still asleep, and they're saying that good times are coming. Saints, we are in the last days. We are in the final last days. And there are so many people that are not going to make it in because you have built your treasures in this life. You have built your treasures here. You're complacent. And the Lord is saying, wake up. The Lord is saying, wake up, O thou sleeper. Awake from your drunken slumbers. Hear the word of the Lord in this season and repent of your sins. His delight is that we come to repentance. that we stop, we make teshuva. I love the word teshuva in Hebrew because it's where we get the English word repentance from. But it means to turn your face away, to turn your face back to the original state. The original state is God in heaven, is what it was in the Garden of Eden before the fall. And we are not repenting. We are treating the blood of Jesus as though it is something that is common. The blood of Jesus, the blood of Yeshua, is not fire insurance. It is not to be taken as something common. It is not your excuse to sin, saints. It is not. That is not what it's there for. The scriptures in Hebrews warn us not to do that. That those people, that it would be not enough blood or sacrifices to even cover those sins. And yet that is what we're doing, saints. And I'm here to warn you. And again, as I said in the beginning, it doesn't matter what you think of me as a person. I'm a flawed individual. I've had to repent of many things. I've had to be humbled in many ways. Even in the 16 years of ministry, God has had to humble me many times and show me things the way he wanted them to be. I am no one special, but hear the words that are coming from my mouth. We have to repent and we have to prepare, saints. War is coming to our coastlands. War is coming to America because of our wickedness, because of the wickedness of our politicians, because of the wickedness in the church, because the church refuses to admit that we are in the last days and we are walking around with blind eyes and deaf ears. And because of that, judgment has been pronounced upon this nation. And we need to prepare, saints. This is not about trying to save our country. This is not what it's about, saints. Judgment is written. It has been pronounced. It's about preparing your hearts. It's about preparing your minds. It's about preparing your souls. It's about making sure that your lamps are filled, that your garments are without spot or wrinkle, saints. It's about preparing your households. It's about praying over your children and your grandchildren. It's about the spouses covering their households and covering one another. It's about loving your neighbor. It's about forgiving those who have offended you. It is about turning away from your wickedness and looking up into the light of the Son of Righteousness and beholding his glory and beholding the ministry of Jesus Christ. That is what it's about in this season, saints. And we need to hear this, what I'm saying to you today. It's not even about me, saints. It's about what the Spirit of the Lord is saying in this season, because we are not paying attention. That was 3 days ago. This morning, I had another dream during the fourth watch. And this dream happened this morning, saints. And then the Lord told me I had to make this video today because I knew 3 days ago I had to come and make this video and warn you about the previous dream. But this one was even to the second half or the topper. And basically, I was in this high-rise building. And in the dream, saints, I was in this high-rise building like an apartment, even though I don't live in an apartment. But I had my laptop like I have right now in front of you, and I was doing this video. I was doing this video that I'm talking about right now, and I was talking about the dream, and I was talking about the word that God had given me, and I was warning the people, saints. And then I was seeing in the dream something that I didn't quite understand, but because it didn't technically make sense to me when I came out of the dream, but in the dream, it made all the sense in the world. I was talking about the darkness. I was talking about the scripture when Jesus said to work while it is still light, for soon night will come and darkness will come and no man would be able to work. And I was sharing this in my video, in my dream, the video that I'm sharing with you right now, okay? And I was saying about the days of light. Now, I know in reality, we have 12 hours of daylight. That is your typical minus the winter months or what have you. We have 12 hours typically of daylight. That is the typical thing. But in this dream, I was going by the afternoon, the peak of the day from 12 p.m. to 6 p.m. And I was seeing that is the peak of light. And I said, but from 6 p.m. to midnight, that is where the darkness comes in. And I was telling the people we were in the second half. I said, we're in the 6 p.m. to midnight and darkness has descended. And I said, and as I'm saying this in my video, the place began to get dark And I stopped my video to look out the window because I knew it was daytime. And I said to myself, why is it so dark? And I turned and I looked outside and I noticed that the darkness had descended in the skies. And I got up from where I was sitting, where my laptop was, and I went to go look out the window. And I noticed there was a black storm. It was a storm with black clouds that had rolled in. And the wind was blowing, and I watched below as the trees began to bend, and I'm looking at the traffic, and I'm looking at people who are trying to run to get out of the storm. And then I looked straight ahead again, and I saw tornadoes in the distance, big, wide tornadoes, and they began to form, and then they began to dissipate, and then they would reform, and then they would dissipate, and it was three of them. And as they would form, they would tear up whatever was in their sight, and then they would dissipate. And then I would watch as they would reform, and they were moving all over this place, this city, wherever I was, and I knew what it meant. I knew trouble was coming. And I left the windows and I was thinking in the dream that I needed to call my mother. And I knew she was just like down the street in the dream. In reality, this is nothing of the sort. But in the dream, I knew she was just a few minutes away. But I looked out one more time and I saw that the lights began to go out in sections. It was like there were just these sections that were losing power and it was coming towards me. And I said, okay. And then the lights in my building went out. And I thought, okay, well, now I can't finish my video. And then I went to go grab my phone because I still had phone service. And the dream ended with me calling my mom. And that was it. And I came out of the dream this morning. And when we have dreams about storm things, and I've had several over the years, I don't have them all the time, but I do have them. And there always been significant of storms in the spirit realm brewing. Storms that are coming that we're not prepared for, saints. We're not ready for it. And the significance, there were three tornadoes representing, I know, three seasons of storms. Saints, we have entered a time of famine. We have had our 7 years of plenty, and now we are in our 7 years of scarcity. We are in our 7 years of famine. We have already entered into it. And I need you to understand that things are not going to get better. And I also, more importantly, need the church to understand that this whole idea that nothing bad is going to happen to the United States before the return of the Lord, a return of his bride, a rapture, whatever you want to call it, okay? Because everybody has their different beliefs. There's pre, mid, post, whatever. I don't get into any of that. But I need you to understand that this is not true. War is coming to our shores, saints. War is coming to our shores. They're planning, and I need you to understand. I have came across one of the most bone-chilling headlines. This was after I had this dream, okay? And I don't remember who the link was, but I if I find it, I'll put it in the bottom because I'm subscribed to newsreels because I don't watch television, okay? I don't have TV in my house. I have internet, but no television. I've shared this before. The Lord pulled me away from TV 3 years ago, okay? It's a distraction for me. That's just for me, okay? This has allowed me to press in again, different seasons in my life, different seasons than I am now, completely different from when a lot of you heard me first in 2015 on Rick Wiles. I'm not even that same person anymore. I'm just being really honest with you, okay? But I still have these newsreels because, and they're international newsreels because, so I can keep up with what's going on in the world. Saints, this most bone-chilling headline came out, I think it was 2 days ago. I think it was Monday, because today is Wednesday. And basically, the Russian, Vladimir Putin, okay, the president of Russia, or maybe it was his prime minister, I'm not sure which one it was, made the announcement that if there are any states, as in the United States, the individual states, that would like to defect and join the Russian Federation, the Russian Federation, that they would consider that. They made this announcement, okay? Now, Some of you may hear that and you may roar in laughter, like, are you crazy? What are you talking? No, I need you to hear what they're saying without saying it, and yet they're saying it. They're giving us the opportunity ahead of schedule, saints, because they are planning to invade us. And I've talked about this on videos before. The Lord's given me dreams, but I'm not one of many, 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 many. Again, I'm a nobody. I'm just another grain of sand on the beach. But God has given me dreams. He showed me the alignment between Turkey and Russia before they made their military pact. This is back in 2016, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that I was given this. It's on our Watchmen on the Wall page, and I posted this before, where I saw them invading us. I have been shown this multiple times, saints, but I'm again a speck of sand on the beach. There are great men and women of God who have gone home to be with the Lord, who have been shown that years ago, 20, 30, 40 years ago, saints, that Russia was going to invade our country. They are planning, saints. I don't know when, but I know you all heard about them downplaying Biden's hand, that we are closer to Armageddon than we've ever been. And then they scolded him for saying that. And he spent all week now trying to backtrack his steps as to what he's meant and what he said. And he even tried to do an interview last night, trying to give a warning without warning to Russia as far as nuclear is concerned. Saints, I don't know if it's going to be nuclear or not. I don't know. But I know that in 1999, I knew, and it was spoken to me, and I was in college at that time, that Putin would be a key factor in the tribulation, specifically the tribulation. And I knew this in 1999. I've been watching this man since then, okay? I didn't even come back to the Lord until the end of 2005. But in 99, I knew that this man was going to be a key factor in the last days. And so I know that we underestimate Russia. And I don't even know if we've underestimated. I just feel like when it comes to America, we're constantly bombarded by media, whether it's social media, whether it's reality television, whether it's video games or digital gadgets or you know, fake news, real news, up news, down news. Just we're bombarded with so much distraction, saints, that we have been numbed. We have become desensitized to the things that we hear. And that's not just the world, saints. It's the church. The church has become desensitized to what's happening. And so I'm here to warn you. And again, I'm telling you, I'm pleading with you. I beseech you to listen to the words that I'm telling you today and share it with people. Share with the members of your family that are struggling with their walk with Christ. The end is here, saints. The end of all things is here. And so many of us are going to be left behind. So many of us are going to be here to receive the mark of the beast. Yes, the Christians, because they can't, there's no fight in us. We're cowards. All Satan has to do is the simplest things, you know, send us a cold or stub our toes, and we have no fight in us. We become cowards. We don't do anything. We're not serving God. We sit in these churches. We sit in these ministries and we suck up all the words. We suck up all the prophecies. We suck up all the words of knowledge and we do nothing with them. We bury them like the person with the talent, the one talent that was given to him, and he buried it. And this is so many of us in the church. God hired us as vine dressers for his vineyard. It is his vineyard. This world is his vineyard. And our job is to cultivate his garden. And yet we are wicked. We have cultivated the garden to keep it for ourselves. Some of us have done no cultivation. But the king is coming. And he's looking for the fruit that is due to him to be rendered to him in his due season, as he said in the parable in the Gospel of Matthew 21. And some of us, most of us, we should be presenting bushels and bushels from his vineyard, and most of us are going to be empty-handed. Most of us only going to have two or three grapes in our hands, and others are the thieves that are going to try to keep it for themselves because they built their treasures in this life. They built their platforms in this life, and it wasn't about this life. We are not citizens of this life. This is not our home. This is not our destination, saints. Everything that is here is temporal. Everything that is here is passing away, and it is coming to an end very, very soon. The last thing I want to share, I want to warn, one of the things that the Lord gave me in September, he whispered in my ear, and I believe I talked about this on my podcast. You can find our podcast on Spotify or on Anchor, and or you can go to our website at faithfulwalkhealingministries.com. And check and click on the Watchman on the Wall. On the top right-hand corner, you will see Spotify or Anchor. But find us there because I did the Watchman on the Wall podcast, and it was called Winter's War, if you have not already listened to it. And in this, I warned how in September, the Lord spoke to me and told me we needed to begin to really pray starting October 1st, that we needed to go into a spiritual warfare that we had never gone into before. That through the fall into the winter, we were going to have a brutal winter. And I'm telling you, we are going to have a brutal winter worldwide. And I'm not just talking about weather-wise, even though that is included. We are going to have a brutal winter. We're going to see shortages. We're going to see inflation is going to continue to impact us. Rising gas prices are going to continue to impact us, and so on and so forth. And we need to prepare, saints. This is across the planet. This is not just for the United States. But we needed to pray, especially during the month of October. I need you to understand, we still have Christians that are still toying with this Halloween thing. We have Christians out here. This is the thing about playing in the darkness and playing in the miry clay, and we're blaming grace for it. We're saying, well, we thank God for the blood of Jesus and his grace, but God has called us to fly and soar with eagles, and too many of us are still down clucking with chickens. We're still playing in the tar pits, and we're saying, well, oh, I have grace. I have the grace of Jesus, and you may have the grace to play in the tar pits, but at what point do you come higher? At what point did God tell you, I need you to shave this off and I need you to drop that so that you can come higher? And we won't do it. We won't do it because we want to celebrate our holidays. We want to take our kids trick-or-treating. We want to sit here. And I'm not just talking about all holidays. I'm specifically talking about this Halloween, this demonic day of All Hallows Eve. The origin is satanic and from the devil. And you still got Christians out here thinking that this is a joke. There's still Christians out here thinking and playing with this and still taking their children out to these churches that, oh, they're changing the name. Listen, you need to look at the scriptures in Haggai chapter 2, I believe it is, where it talks about a parable where if you, about defilement, and basically you cannot take something that is defiled and make it holy. You need to look at that and understand it, because we're out here, we're taking defiled things. We've incorporated so much darkness into the church that we don't even know that we're surrounded in darkness. We don't even understand the light because we've incorporated so much darkness in our lives and in our church. And we just think that we can throw some holy oil on it or tallit, or we can pray over it and it's okay. But Haggai tells us that that is not the case. You cannot do that. And we need to stop playing games with darkness, saints. We need to quit playing double dutch with Satan, because we're getting caught up in the ropes and we're falling flat on our faces in the process. In February, the Lord gave me a warning. I told you all, and you go back to that video, a warning regarding our little ones, where I saw massive graves. They were tiny graves in symmetrical rows, and I saw people begin to bury their children. They were wrapped in swaddling clothes. They weren't even in coffins, and the mothers and the parents were laying these tiny babies into these graves. And I talked about how these graves were so small that they could have been anywhere from an infant to maybe up to kindergarten age, maybe 5 years old or so, but nothing greater than that. And I warned then in February, I said, we need to pray for our little ones. There are events coming that is going to take the lives of our children. And I warned it. I even talked about being wise about our medical decisions regarding our children. I put this out in February, saints. I just want to let you know, and I need you to understand that we think of All Hallows Eve as October 31st. The people who are in witchcraft, and I'm trying not to overrun this time, but I need you to understand that there are more people operating in the dark arts in this season than they ever are before. I need you to understand that there are people who have left the churches, saints, especially in the African American community. They have left Christianity in droves, and they have gone into ancestral worship. They've gone into voodoo. They've gone, there are people who are incorporating Christianity with things like Santeria and hoodoo and New Age and all of this stuff. There's so many people in witchcraft right now. There's so many people in the church. Saints, they have infiltrated our churches. They have infiltrated our churches, and they're pretending to be prophets. They're pretending to be prophets, and we don't have any discernment, saints. And we're flocking to them because we hear this accuracy, but we forget that Satan is accurate. We forget that Jesus warned us in Matthew 24 that many false Christs and false prophets would arise in the last days, and that they would be performing signs and miracles, and that the elect would be deceived if it were possible. But what prevents the elect from being deceived is the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, who is the truth bearer, who lets us know that even though it looks like a duck, it walks like a duck, it talks like a duck, but it's not a duck. It's not a duck. But so many of us are deceived because we're not in our prayer closets. We're not in our words. We're too stuck on YouTube. We're too stuck. We spend our whole lives on Facebook and Instagram and TikTok and all of these other places. And we have no relationship with the King. We have no relationship with the King. Or we'll go to a church, but we won't pray. We'll go to a church or a Bible study, but we won't fast. We'll go listen to somebody on YouTube, but we won't read our Bibles for ourselves. We won't spend time. Psalm 91:1 says, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. It says that scripture is called the covenant of protection. The covenant of protection, but you cannot claim a covenant of protection if you have not dwelt in the secret place. If you do not understand the presence of God, then he cannot be your refuge. He cannot be your fortress. He cannot be your shield and buckler if you have not spent time with him. If you don't know what it's like to continuously dwell in the presence of the Most High, of Adonai, then you cannot claim protection in a time like this. I need you to know that in the dark arts, the witches and the warlocks, the people who do seances and black magic, they celebrate from October 1st to November 1st. It is an entire month of practicing, of preparing, of celebration, of rituals, of spells, of sacrifices. And saints, we always think about the stories of the old, and you look up the history of All Hallows Eve with the Druids and European paganism or what have you. And then there are other people who go into the Satanism or black magic or what have you. And there is sacrifice is real. Sacrifice is real, saints. Blood sacrifice is real, and it still happens today. It's happening even in our country. And we think of, I have this paper in front of me because I need to read to you what has happened to our babies. This is all since October 1st. And I need you to understand, we need to stop playing with darkness, saints. Our babies are being killed. And I'm talking babies. I'm not talking teenagers. I'm talking about babies. They're being killed, saints. I'm going to read to you a small list, and I encourage you to go do some research on this. I encourage you to do research on this, but I have to read this to you. This is just since October 1st, okay? There were newborns in Texas that were killed. A man, an 18-year-old man, I know he was possessed by demon saints. He ran into a maternity ward. He had no children there. He broke in, saints, and screaming. And I don't know if he was, I think he was high on drugs, but he was, you have to understand that pharmakia is sorcery, it's witchcraft. And he went in to saw a woman who had just given birth to her baby, sitting in the room with the baby. He runs into the room. He snatches the baby up. He chokes the baby till it turns blue. He drops the baby. He busses into the nursery. He starts grabbing babies out the nursery ward and choking them, screaming, die, die, die. Then they were apprehending him. He picked up one baby like he was going to throw it to the ground. They finally apprehended him, but it was a struggle. He was strong. This boy was full of demons. He was completely demon possessed. I want to talk about how there was a 2-year-old and a 5-month-old in the state of Tennessee that was mauled to death by the family dogs. These babies were eaten by the family dogs that I guess prior had not shown any type of aggression. There's a lot of that happening right now. There's a lot of stories with dogs turning and on their parents, their masters, whatever you want to call them. There's a lot of that going on. If you don't understand that, look up Revelation chapter 6 and the 4th seal about the beast of the field. There's a toddler that has mysteriously disappeared in the state of Georgia. They're still searching for this baby's body. They don't know what happened to this baby or where it went. There's no trace of it. There was a car crash, and of all the people in the car, the baby was ejected from its car seat in the state of Florida and killed. There was a 3-year-old who was accidentally ran over by a family member in the state of Illinois, just outside of Chicago a couple of days ago. A 23-month-old baby was killed by her father in New York the other day. There was a 3-year-old that was killed in a house fire in the state of Missouri. I don't know if you all know, but there was a man who went in on a killing spree in the country of Thailand in a daycare center. He killed 37 people. Of the 37 people, 30 of them were babies. These are daycare. This is not school. This is daycare. These are babies. These are infants. These are toddlers, saints. There was an aunt who killed her 5-year-old nephew in Las Vegas the other day. A 2-month-old was killed by a random bullet in a shooting in Kansas. There was a grandmother last week who was in the park with her 2-year-old or her 2 or 3-year-old that was randomly shot and killed. There was a 3-year-old who overdosed, quote unquote, accidentally of fentanyl in the state of North Carolina. And that's just the ones that I pointed out. If you look up the countless children that have been killed since October 1st in car crashes, that's another thing. I'm talking, and then there was that entire family that was kidnapped in California, and they found their all of their bodies, and they had killed everybody, including the 8-month-old baby. Okay? Then there is a warning that is out for Halloween this year, that they are putting fentanyl, someone has tipped off the feds, that it is a possibility of fentanyl being put in the Halloween candy. And they are putting out warnings. They have already found some traces of this, I don't know what, on the West Coast, okay? Do your research on that. But they're warning parents about candy for Halloween this year, that it might possibly be laced with fentanyl. Saints, I need you to understand that in the dark magic and the black magic and Satanism, in it, the shedding of innocent blood is the most potent power in witchcraft. And people think that, you know, when I was a kid and I grew up in the south side of Chicago, and I remember there were times where there were incidences throughout the 80s and the 90s where kids were being mouths were being cut up, where they were putting broken pieces of glass and candy bars and needles and things of that nature. That went on for quite some time. But nowadays, saints, with technology, with everything that's happening, with the increase of witchcraft, these people are, they can even astral project. These things can astral project into other people. They can do rituals where demons of unbelievers like this 18-year-old can be completely possessed and go on killing sprees like he did in a maternity ward in Texas. and kill innocent blood. It is all the shedding of innocent blood to invoke power of demonic forces and principalities. And we need to understand this. Again, I warned about our babies in the month of February. I warned. I said, we need to cover our children. And I'm back again to remind you of that warning. And also to remind those who are still out here tampering and dabbling with dark arts like celebrating Halloween. I don't care if you change the name of it to Trunk or Treat or Hallelujah Night or all of this foolishness that you all are calling it. It is still a night of demonic forces, witches, warlocks, and satanic rituals, no matter what you call it. And we need to be more prepared. We need to be wiser about our decisions. We need to make better decisions as Christians, as parents, as leaders, about dabbling with darkness. Darkness is ever increasing, but it should be a time where our lights should shine brighter than they ever have before. But for many, our lights have become all but smoldering wicks because we have not grown in Christ. And darkness is steady growing power, and we're steady growing weaker. But now is the time to stand. This is the time to rise up as a body of Christ, to stop taking Christ for granted, to stop taking the blood of Jesus and treating it as though it is something that is common. It is time to repent, saints. It is time to prepare. It is time to cast off the weights that have been holding us down and the little things that have been tripping us up. And it's time for us to wash our robes in the blood of the Lamb so that when he comes, he said, when I come, when I return, will I find faith? But the scripture lets us know that Christ is only returning for a bride whose garments are white, without spot or wrinkle. So I want to thank you for hearing me today, for letting me into your homes. As I said, please share this with everyone, the believer and the unbeliever. Warn them. Warn them. Trouble is coming. Until next time, thank you, saints. God bless you, and shalom. Thank you.